Planning Policy Committee on Infrastructure Renewal and Public Works for this Thursday, April 19th, 2018. I have with me my council colleagues, Councilor Sharma, Councilor Barotti, and also our senior clerk, Ms. McMillan. May I have a motion regarding Councilor Pactican being away on city business?
Certainly, Mr. Chairman, I'll move a leave of absence for city business for Councilor Pactican.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Carried. Now, we don't need a motion for the minutes, okay? I'd just like to, before we commence, acknowledge that this meeting is taking place on Treaty 1 land in the traditional homeland of the Métis Nation. Number one on our agenda is...
Mr. Chair, just before we begin, I'd like to thank the public service, and I know I speak on behalf of yourself probably, yeah. Mr. Chair, and Councilor Barotti, thank you for these reports. I know it's difficult to put them together in a short time frame, but we had a lengthy discussion at the last meeting, and I think it just bodes well for openness and transparency. So thank you very much for putting these reports together and for calling the special meeting.
Yeah, I would echo those sentiments. I've had a chance to go through the reports, and I think there's lots of really great information in here, and it really gives us a very good insight as to the thought process that you go through and the materials management rules that you have to follow when you're determining how to award these contracts. So, yeah, thank you for this information.
I echo the same comments.
Yeah, thank you. So report number one is the report award of a contract for City of Winnipeg Downtown Bike Lane System and Street Improvements, 2018-2019 Pavement Renewals.
That's report number three.
That's two.
That's two. Oh, these are then in the wrong order in my binder. Apologies.
The first report is the award of contract for the 2018 Industrial Streets Renewal Program, Chevrier Boulevard.
Okay, could you take us through that report, please?
Sure. So, contract... We would like to award a contract to Bayview Construction in the amount of $5.95 million, which is within the budget for that project right now. And that work includes reconstruction of Chevrier from Pembina Highway to Trache Bay. And then from Trache Bay to Waverly, there's a mill and fill treatment on that part. The project is a PTIF funded, and as such, including protected bike lanes on both sides of the road from Pembina to Waverly. So when you look at the report, we had 6 bids. And they range from $5.95 million up to $8 million. So the contract is within budget.
And the PTIF funding, is that 100%?
It's 50% funding.
So the $7.5 million, though, is that all PTIF money, or is it PTIF?
No. I think $3 million of this one is PTIF money, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay.
And then the rest is city money,
and that
it's slightly under the half, 50%.
Yeah. And that grant has been finalized and approved with the federal government?
That's ongoing. We're still waiting to sign agreements with it, but we have approval in principle on those.
Okay. Very good. Just to maybe, if I may, I know my counselor, my colleagues may have other questions. I think I understand this, but when I look at the numbers, this contract is $5.9 million, but the total project cost is $7.5 million. Could you, so there's lots of numbers here that aren't really applicable to the award, specific award of this contract.
They're not applicable to the award, but they're applicable to the budget, and they demonstrate that we're staying within the budget for that project.
Okay. Yeah.
So like things like engineering, traffic signals, traffic services, Manitoba Hydro costs, there's railway costs involved in this one because there's several railway crossings that we have to cross. So all of those things have to add up into the total budget cost.
Okay, very good. Any questions, comments?
No, I've reviewed the report and the project, and good to, of course, see the federal funds being utilized here. And when we're doing the road works, we're incorporating the complete streets and active transportation at that time, so I'm encouraged by that. I'm prepared to remove the administrative recommendations.
Okay, we have a motion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Carried. The next item on the agenda is the award of the, for the downtown bike lane system. Okay, let me just pull some of that.
Okay, so in this one, we're looking for an award of approximately $9 million to JC Paving. And this is for the downtown bike lane street improvement system. To be more descriptive, this includes reconstruction of Notre Dame from Portage Avenue to Princess, mill and fill rehabilitation of Princess from William to Notre Dame, reconstruction of Gary Street from Portage to Notre Dame, and all of that work is anticipated to be done in 2018. It's a two-year project. So in 2019, we're anticipating to, or we would be doing the rehabilitation of Gary from Assiniboine Avenue to Portage Avenue, and that includes a bi-directional bike lane facility on it as well.
Is this bid for the bike lane? Oh, this is bike lane and street approval.
Yeah, so this is basically all of Gary Street from Assiniboine all the way up through into Notre Dame Avenue into Princess. It's a very long project.
What part of it is the where are the new bike lanes going?
They're going between Portage, Assiniboine and Portage.
On Gary. Yeah, so that's the one that was talked about for a while ago, right by the police headquarters there.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
Currently, there's a shared bike lane on the roadway, as it sounds.
Yeah. But not Portage to Notre Dame? Not Portage to Notre Dame?
No, Portage to Assiniboine right now. On there, you have that bike lane stretch on the shared path from Notre Dame to Portage as well. On the existing, it's on the eastern side of the roadway.
So actually, the from Portage to Notre Dame includes the bi-directional bike lanes. There's painted bike lanes from William to Notre Dame as well.
On Princess,
right.
Okay. So again, what's being done? So the $9.1 million is just for this year?
No, that's two-year construction project. That's the full construction for both years.
Okay, then the 13.6 is what number then?
13.6 is the total estimated cost of the project.
Okay.
So, and the budget was 17.6. So we have approximately a $4 million surplus on this project, or within the local and regional street program that would be applied to other projects that go up and down.
Yep.
The program fluctuates.
Yeah, the nine million is the award of the construction portion of the contract, and there's other things in the project such as the engineering,
the hydro, all the rest
of that stuff, and that accumulates up to the 13.6.
And the funding is from both the 2018 and 2019 capital budget. There was already a first charge on the 2019 budget within the 2018 budget approvals.
Yeah.
So the approved budget was 17.6.
Yeah.
The bids, the total project estimated cost is 13.6.
Right. So there's $4 million unallocated. Okay.
And of that 13.6, $9 million was the winning bid.
Yes.
In JC Paving.
So when you look at the bids also range from $9 million to $12.7 million.
Yeah.
There's only three bids, so it's a very good price.
Yeah.
Okay.
Going forward, when we're doing these downtown cycle pieces, I really would feel a lot more comfortable doing the movable ones first, just to make sure we have the absolute right locations and that there's public support and all these other pieces. I realize the majority of this money is to rebuild the streets. It's not about, this isn't $13 million for, or $9 million for building AT or cycling downtown. I'm not against our, you know, building this downtown cycle grid. I am a little nervous building permanent concrete where it hasn't existed before. I know we do have the temporary, or we do have the painted lanes, but not the partitioned pieces.
Not protected to any, like even a minor protection such as the curb, the temporary.
I know Princess, we have them from, it's all the way from Lee James through to Bannatyne or McDermott. McDermott, I think, painted, but not that final stretch from McDermott to Notre Dame, for example. That's not painted. There's nothing there at the moment. So this is introducing that for the first time. So again, I feel a little more comfortable if in the future we could use that as a tool, but regardless.
We are using that as a tool on Bannatyne this year, too. Mm-hmm. So there's that Bannatyne project.
Good to hear that.
Yeah, we are doing one. We have Sherbrooke. And I think that is a good concept to examine. And these ones, there were, I think, quite robust public consultations that took place before this one, this project was awarded, correct?
That's right. And this project is, it was conceived a few years ago. It's taken a while to get it off the ground. We were actually wanting to tender last year, actually.
So are we losing any parking by doing this? I mean, again, I'm debating the merits, not the actual funding here today, but just for information.
That I don't have that detail with me right now.
Maybe in terms of the Bannatyne adjustable lanes, you could update us at a future meeting.
Sure.
As to how that is going.
Yeah. Sure. Mr. Chair, I'm prepared to move the administrative recommendation to award.
Okay. We have a motion. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Lastly is the firmware one. Chair, can take us through that?
Sure. So firmware is a capital budget amendment as well as an award. So the project closed higher than we anticipated it to close, and we're looking to transfer money into the project. So the project is funded from a few different sources. There's funded under the Firmer Bridge Project, and it's also funded under the local and regional street renewal program as well. So we're proposing to transfer $3 million from a project currently underway is the Saskatchewan Avenue Culvert Project. And that project was well under budget, and we can easily transfer the $3 million in there and leave a sufficient contingency to complete that work on that project. Then we would be transferring or using up $1.5 million of surplus from the local and regional program as well to increase the budget from $25 million to $29.5 million. So that's where this one's at. This one is a major capital project, so we would also be reporting to the Standing Policy Committee on Finance, and the first meeting is on May 9th that we're going to report to on that one. I know you might have a lot of questions on this one, so maybe I'll just let you
one element of this project is the brick of the tunnel under Firmore.
Yes.
I wonder if you could just talk about what that means for the connectivity of the AT system.
So when we were studying the project, we could see that there's a lot of people that cross Firmer at grade, so it's a very big safety concern. So it's not just an active transportation amenity, it's actually a safety concern. There's a well-worn path where people walk across the road. It's a 70-kilometer-an-hour posted speed, more of a highway-type, freeway-type of a system. So installing the tunnel was a safety consideration. That portion of the work is under our Class 3 estimate budget. It's like within 11%.
Councilor Broadchair.
Again, this is within the Class 3 range that, you know, we went to market with. You know, we saw in the last two examples where I think we probably came in under the Class 3 number. Were there aspects of the materials we supplied to the market that led the prices to go up? I mean, you know, market conditions. I mean, from the time that, you know, we do the engineering, prepare a Class 3 estimate, and the market conditions of the province, the private sector are down, you know, we tend to get better pricing. We seem to see the opposite trend here. Was there an engineering piece that was missed by our consultants, or is this more complicated for some reason, or is bridge work, you know, obviously a different skill set and different bidders than just, you know, road construction? What's sort of the...
There's a number of things, and like at the Class 3 estimate, the consultant doing bridge rehabilitations, they're all a little bit unique, and the prices come in are based on the level of risk that the contractor will take. And in this case, our consultants estimated aggressively. They thought that the market conditions with the province not putting out much work would be very good. So they that's the, they correspondingly did their estimates that way. So there was, so I think the level of complexity that, that the marketplace thought the bridge was more expensive. And when we analyzed the bids of the four contractors, the first three on the bridge component are within a couple hundred thousand dollars. So it's very close. So it's the right price. On the roadside, at the preliminary design, we didn't consider paving the shoulders of the road. The shoulders need to be paved as a safety consideration, so that added some additional cost. They also had some quantity errors when they were putting together their estimate, and that was not caught. So there was an additional quantities there. We're also tracking about on street construction costs about 6% high this year. So there's a number of factors that played into it.
That's why you have it last week.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Mr. Chair, I'm prepared to move item 3.
Okay, great. We have a motion. All in favor of item number 3.
Aye.
I didn't hear any.
Aye.
Aye. Sorry.
I'm losing my hearing.
Aye.
Motion to adjourn. All in favor? Carried. We are adjourned.
So we have two more.